Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for frame rate is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com.
This episode is brought to you by Squarespace, the all-in-one platform that makes it fast and easy to create a professional website, blog, portfolio, and now an online store. Check out their new commerce solution so you can start selling stuff immediately. For a free trial and 10% off your first purchase on new accounts, go to squarespace.com and use offer code FRAMERATE3.
Of humility. You think that you can't make mistakes, but there's going to come a moment when you realize you're wrong about that. You're going to get yourself and everyone under your command killed. Think you're safe. You are not.
Welcome to episode 116 of Frame Rate, the show for cord cutters. I'm Tom Merritt.
Howdy, folks. I'm Brian Brushwood, and that was a homemade version of Star Trek Into Darkness from Dust Films Originals. And I love the fact that they can break down all of the elements that go into trailers and just hit each one note perfect, to where at some point, like, you sort of slip into it, and you can almost imagine watching the entire movie that way. Do you ever get that way?
I love the part where they show the action figures going over the cliff into the blue. And I love the feeling it gave me that I was, in fact, watching that same scene.
Dude, what was the shot-for-shot remake of Star Wars that we saw? The completely fan-sourced thing where every person...
Oh, right, yeah, where they just asked people to do little snippets of it. I can't remember what that was called now either, but great example of somebody doing unlicensed parody.
Yes, I see what you did there. Hey, man.
We're referring to last week's big, long fight about School of Thrones, which you should go watch that episode, because Brian and I just had that fight all over again in the pre-show. Okay,
yeah, and you know what? That tells me that apparently I am new to the English language and apparently don't have the ability to speak words without making people think something stupid. Apparently, what everyone hears coming out of my mouth is, no one should be allowed to do parody. Name one parody that people are allowed to do. And that's, of course, not at all what I'm saying. I was saying last week and saying again before the pre-show that I thought that writing a completely separate story with characters and situations that were owned by another network was unprecedented. And people say, of course it's not unprecedented. Here's this example that in no way is similar to what you're talking about. So of course it's precedented. So apparently I suck at describing what it is I'm looking for. But to be honest, until you said the words Chad Vader, not one person, not one email we got, not one person in the chat room had said anything close to what was happening with School of Thrones. I do agree that Chad Vader is an example of exactly that. And
also Galacticast.
Galacticast is like, did they just continue to tell stories in the Battlestar Galactica universe?
Casey McKinnon was the star, and it was a sketch every week parodying a television show or movie.
Okay, but again, they're parodying specific things. They're not writing their own stories in that universe.
Yes.
Okay.
They were essentially writing their own stories in that universe, like, you know, Nazi Hitler and stuff. But okay, there was a different universe every week. I don't know if that undermines your question.
Yes. Yeah, again, not relevant. Okay, again, Brian's inability to apparently...
Okay, so Brian keeps narrowing the definition, and people, here's what we need to do.
This is
find
the same
examples on the internet, particularly, we actually don't want television. We want internet, because that's a one-to-one comparison to School of Thrones, of people who have made video series that continually and consistently parody the same universe with their own ongoing story told every week. Is that fair?
Okay, stop. Okay, no, it's not fair. How about we let me say the words that I mean? Because I'm trying to make sure I've got it right. Here's specifically what I'm asking is I have never seen a consistent series that told new stories with existing intellectual property that belonged to somebody else. Now, again, you can say parody, but as I continue to watch specifically School of Thrones, I'm getting engrossed in their story. And it's not a story. I'm not engrossed in the parody. Like, I see what the nods are, but they're telling their own story, which I think is great and I think is awesome. But outside of, like, you've got certainly the extended stories of the Star Trek universe, which, of course, belongs to Paramount. But Paramount has publicly said that we're cool with whatever. We're not going to cause any trouble or whatever. HBO traditionally, I don't think, has been very permissive about this kind of thing.
Do you need it to just be HBO series?
No.
Paramount series.
No. What I'm saying, Tom, if you will tone down the mockery just a touch. What I'm saying is there's a difference between dad not caring what you're up to and dad saying, we'll do whatever, kids, which is what Paramount did, versus what you were saying earlier, which is like, doesn't matter, they're totally protected, which I don't agree from. I don't think that they're I hope they get away with it.
That's where I start to get in an argument with you about whether they're protected or not. But what you have backed up to saying is I want an example. So that's what we're asking for.
Yes, correct. Until Chad Vader, this is a case of me not expressing my confusion. And again, I'm not picking a side. I'm always on the side of everyone parroting everyone and of more people being able to do whatever they want without repercussion. I'm a lazy bastard in that regard. And I firmly believe that everyone should be able to say, do whatever the hell they want, as long as they're not, you know, hurting anyone. But
so would red versus blue count for you?
Yes, it does. And it's a very good example. And it was the one that I was going to bring up had you not stolen it.
Oh, sorry. I really didn't mean to do that.
It was the example that I had come up with beforehand. But again, like, is red versus blue a parody at that point? Because at some point you start to really care about red and blue as their own characters and not as this is hilarious because it's in the Halo universe.
Troopers with the Stormtroopers.
Troopers was a parody and at no point care about the character. Yeah, it was just straight up.
So that's
it was
not enough narrative for you. Okay.
Right. Well, and
not
and
trying to be fun.
Right. No. It, definitely not enough of a narrative. And everything was directly related to – everything was a joke within the universe. But again, the difference is writing your own stories with other people's intellectual property is something that and there is a difference between that and parody. And I just – the more I watch School of Thrones, the less like a parody it looks like and the more it looks like an interesting story of teenagers that just seems to be a reimagining of the conflicts that are in – because I haven't laughed at all watching School of Thrones.
Because it's not funny. I don't know if that means it's not meant to be funny.
Yes. And at that point, like, what is the point of parody then? I don't know.
Isn't always funny. It may not even be meant to be funny. It's just it may be making a political point or something. And there are lots of examples of this in writing. There's lots of people who take other people's characters in writing and transform them and put them in new stories. And there's a lot of controversy over whether that's ethical to do. Even when it is legal. So there's that ground has been well covered. It's actually video where it's less well covered because not that many people have had access to make that much video until recently with the internet.
Well, and again, just to be clear, just so we can head off those emails before they come, not saying anything about this series, not saying about whether it should exist or shouldn't exist. I just think this is an interesting idea that deserves exploration, and I can't think of other precedents outside
John Strickland points out Legend of Neil. Do you know Legend of Neil?
No, I'm not familiar with that. What was that?
Parody of Legend of Zelda.
Okay. And so he was just telling his own story with Neil with
the
Zelda
characters. Yeah, with taking the characters from
I don't know. I don't know. I just think this is an interesting space, and I'd love to hear more examples. And you guys can send us emails at framerate@twit.tv or fr@twit.tv.
But that's not, in fact, the big story. This is the big story.
This just in, the big story.
Cablevision came to your aid fighting against bundles. Now Verizon seems to be wanting to do the same thing. Verizon Fios provides a television service as well as an internet service. And they are trying to go, they're taking a little different tactic. They're not using the courts. They're trying to go to individual smaller and medium-sized channels and strike new deals that get them to only charge for the number of viewers that watch their channel based on Verizon's internal numbers. So Verizon's saying, look, we'll pay you a different carriage fee, but it's going to be based on how many people watch you. So if you make us carry another channel, great, but we're only going to pay you for the people who actually watch it. Now, the thing to keep in mind here is if they're successful with this, with the small and medium people, and the market keeps changing and there's more pressure on channels from outsiders like Netflix and Amazon and whatnot, then Verizon may be able to use this to get the big guys to agree to the same thing. And then eventually that could lead to some sort of unbundling situation.
I love that they have the intestinal fortitude to go for this, but I just don't see it actually working. Because think about what an unprecedented move this would be, says the guy who everyone agrees can't understand what the word unprecedented means. The idea that they could accept delivery of content and stream it out to everyone on their broadcast network and yet somehow not pay for it just because they were able to monitor that nobody bothered to. If we're going to think in analog terms, they bought the print to all these movies. They opened up their 600-channel Cineplex. They played all the movies, but then they say, well, we played like half these movies. Like nobody even came in. Like we had one guy. Can we just pay you for the one guy who watched this movie, even though our cost? And again, this is a bad metaphor because I'm king of the bad
metaphors.
Actually,
it's an interesting metaphor though, because the theaters pay a fee to get the movie that is not based on the number of tickets they sell.
Correct. Yes, correct. They pay to rent the print, and likewise, they pay for the bandwidth to put it in. Now, it gets a little bit more complicated because you have all these providers who say that you have to bundle. If you're going to get AMC, you got to get this other thing, although the AMC is a bad example because they went independent, but you know what I'm talking about. I just feel like it's two things. Number one, as we see the unwinding of the traditional business model, we start to see bigger and bigger companies taking larger and more, from the outside, outrageous risks. And I'm going to say that's good news for cord cutters because it indicates that there's a wind blowing, you know, changes on the horizon is what I hope. But as for this specific case, this is more Zadiva than Aereo. How about that? You like that? You like that little throwback that I just threw out to
yeah,
you?
Yeah, it's definitely not Aereo. Well, Zadiva got shut down by the law. This isn't going to get shut down by the law.
No, but what I mean is like Aereo, when you looked at it, you're like, that's a pretty ironclad case. They're going to – this is a good one to fight on. Zadiva, even though I feel like they were morally right, is just on murkier territory and I
well,
felt like that's
about
part of
cable vision? Because what Verizon's doing isn't a legal fight. What Verizon's doing is a negotiation. They're just
yes,
saying, like,
correct.
We want to change the deal. You want to be carried by Verizon Fios, little channel. You're going to agree to these new terms. So
I don't feel like they've
precedent for the big guys later.
Right. What I am saying is I don't think it's going to work. I think that they're going to get shut down. I think there's going to be some kind of pissing contest. And then there's going to be, you know, these channels aren't available because they expect us to pay for them, whether you watch them or not. Is that right? And I don't see that getting traction.
Well, here's the one thing that makes me a little more optimistic about this is the small and medium channels are the ones that always fight for carriage. And we talked about this on Tech News Today, I pointed out Tech TV with some partners had to pay for carriage, not get paid for carriage. So
right.
If Verizon Fios comes to you and says, guess what? We're not going to make you pay for carriage, or we're going to increase the numbers that you get paid for carriage, but it's going to be based on viewership. Those little guys may be like, sign me up. So the isn't so much getting the channels to sign up at the smaller levels. It's then making that transition. Like you got to lay that precedent, right? Like we do this with other people. Otherwise, nobody's going to listen to you. And this is what they mentioned in the Wired article about this from Roberto Baldwin, is that with the increasing pressure of original channels on Netflix, original programming on Netflix, on Amazon, even on Hulu, all of a sudden, in a couple of years, if Verizon has made this a precedent, they can place pressure on these bigger companies like a Disney with an ESPN to say, you know what? We're not going to take ESPN2. And you kind of need us right now because people are fleeing to these other services. So we will take your bundled channels, but only on a pay-per-subscriber basis.
Yeah, I'll tell you what. It's an interesting situation where it's like weirdly the free fall as people and as we'll talk about in one of our upcoming stories, you know, more and more people moving to cutting the cord. It's one of those things where it's like it's a hard read for me to know who has the power, because you think on the face of it that the cable companies are the ones that are screwed because they're the ones who provide high quality HD content to people who now they're being circumvented. But that also the fact that it appears that they have nothing to lose allows them to make these kind of outrageous demands where they could totally try to shake up the very nature of the network that they're in.
And they've got the numbers on their side still. That may not stay forever, but we've got another story about that in a minute. But first, let's talk about another big story.
Stop everything. It's another big story.
Veronica Mars. People love it. They miss it. They want it to come back. They tried to get a movie going. It didn't happen. Now it looks like they might actually get a movie thanks to Kickstarter. Rob Thomas and Kristen Bell are on board. They still would have to get the other actors on board and the script together. But they went to Warner and said, we'd really like to do this on Kickstarter. Will you guys give us the blessing? Because, you know, you own the rights for us to make this movie. And Warner, according to Rob Thomas, was very cool about it and said, look, if you can get $2 million off Kickstarter, that will show us there's enough fan interest here that we will go ahead with the project and we'll try to make this happen. Now, there's, like I said, you still got to get all the actors scheduled and a script together and all of that sort of thing. But this is a huge hurdle to get over. And not only did they get the $2 million, but as of this recording, they've got $3,653,000.
Well, and plus also keep in mind, like in many ways, the Kickstarter model here is even better than what would have happened in traditional Hollywood. What it would have been originally was we got this property. Yes, we own it. Yes, we get that you want to make a movie. And yes, you're telling us that fans want to make it. But what we don't want to, for example, let's go back to Serenity. Serenity was a case where it's like they knew they had tremendous fan interest. They were not able to gauge specifically how much it was. And so you had to have a big studio take a gamble on it. They put out what was $16 or $20 million for it, and it barely made back its money opening weekend, and was considered a flop, even though it went on to make money in DVD sales. But there's an efficiency to Kickstarter where not only can you get that financing for it, but you also get a referendum on how many people are interested in it. So it's like they get valuable intel. So for somebody who owns the property like Veronica Mars, this is nothing but pure win. It's like, sure, if you can raise $2 million and along with that, give us the data on how many people, how fast you raised it. That tells us how many people, how to market this thing so that we can make money from it. I suspect as Kickstarter continues to grow, there's going to be more and more of these stories and that people will eventually have this become the preferred way to try to market and build up buzz for a movie.
Yeah, because essentially, you know, what the distributor and the studio try to do is get people to throw in money. They get a lot of times those executive producer credits you see are people saying, yeah, we'll bring together a little bit of money to put into this project. So as I understand it, what Rob Thomas has done here is said, I'm getting the first EP on board to be the fans.
Right.
And they're going to kick in now $3.5 million.
This is the way old Hollywood would have been, is you would have had to find someone who loved Veronica Mars and believed in it enough that he would put up $3 million of his own money. Now, here's the difference, is when he put up that money, he would expect to make back more than his investment. None of these Kickstarters expect to get back anything on their investment. They
whatever the pledge reward is, right? You know,
right. $4 million of capital raised, and there's no expectation that they have to make the money back. From a studio's perspective, they're laughing all the way to the bank. Now, I'm not going to say it's a bad thing, but understand that this is a fundamentally new situation that you've run into. It's the equivalent of having your internet be your new best friend who's crazy and loves stuff and doesn't care if he makes anything on his investment. And that's what Kickstarter's made possible for Hollywood, which can be a good thing or it can be a very scary bad thing. So it'll be interesting to see. I'm still waiting on the Kickstarter hangover. You know, a lot of people are buying things and we're getting a lot of stuff, but we haven't had any of these really giant scale disasters come of Kickstarter yet that makes us all think twice before we make donations.
There have been a couple, but none of them have been the most popular Kickstarters. There's been a few things that people were pointed to. And what's funny is right before this Veronica Mars Kickstarter launched, I saw a couple stories out there about the death of Kickstarter, how the number of projects being put on Kickstarter was now, you know, on the decline for the first time. And the amount of backers per project was on the decline. And they were like, that may be it for this phenomenon. It may be fading. And then boom, Veronica Mars comes along and just like blows it all up again.
Sure, absolutely. I don't know. And as far as like that hangover moment, there's certainly no one story that everybody can think of. Like there's like we can think of when I say Kickstarter success, you can think of four or five awesome stories that meant something to you when you read them. When I say Kickstarter failure, like the first thing that pops into mind is like, wow, Pebble took longer to deliver than we expected, didn't it? You know, we haven't had a moment where everyone felt scammed and totally ripped off.
Well, the projects that have totally failed out just didn't get enough attention or didn't have the big hype machine behind them that a Pebble or an Ouya hasn't shipped yet.
That's right.
But I remember reading a few stories back in the day when Kickstarter really started to tighten up the sort of like, hey, we need to make sure people know that there is no promise that whatever they're backing will happen. That could be a huge issue if Veronica Mars' movie doesn't get made.
Correct. Or if even worse, if what comes out is so terrible and phoned in and looks like a sci-fi movie of the week that people are like, wow, I feel utterly ripped off for my money. I feel like somebody traded my fandom for dollars that got wasted on hookers and blow.
Oh, Rob Thomas would never let that happen. Come on.
I'm sure.
I'm not even kidding. I'm almost certain of that.
I believe you. I'm just saying that at some point, someone who is above suspicion, right, that will happen. And that's when the Kickstarter hangover is going to hit.
All right. We probably should have swapped these two stories, but here is yet another big story.
Tuck in your bootstraps. It's yet another big story.
And just to be clear, because I noticed some comments in the chat room, Brian and I aren't saying there's never been a Kickstarter that didn't get backed. We're talking about Kickstarters that did get backed, and then the people just kind of ran off to Mexico with the money and nothing ever happened.
There's never been a publicity, a PR nightmare associated with Kickstarter. Something so bad that Kickstarter became synonymous with like, yeah, go ahead and flush your money down the toilet. Trading dreams for nothing. That's what Kickstarter is.
Dreams for nothing and your chicks for free. This big story, however, is actually about those numbers that we're talking about at cord cutters. And this is why I think the cable companies and the video providers like Verizon, Fios feel that they need to act now while time is on their side. Nielsen just released figures from a fourth quarter 2012 cross-platform report back on March 8th that 5 million households, which is less than 5% of U.S. households, are what's called no TV households. Now, that doesn't mean no video. In fact, Nielsen's very kind of fallen all over themselves to say, when we say no TV, we mean they're not getting broadcast or cable television. They are only getting, if they are getting video, they are only getting it in non-traditional ways. 5 million is a lot. In fact, it's double what it was in 2007, which was 2 million, but it's still less than 5%. It's a very tiny slice. So that number is continuing to grow. You've only got so much time, like RIM and Nokia before you, before the little Android and iPhone market share numbers gobble you up.
Right. Well, and keep in mind also that this is a two-pronged attack, because not only do you have the slow conversion of the masses as they wake up to the convenience of getting video on demand or services make it easier to get the content that they care about, you know, new seasons of better content come out on Netflix and so on. The big thing that you have to look about is this, just as we've worried for years about the aging baby boomer population, we've got these millennials coming up who have never understood the appeal of sitting in a living room with their parents, everyone watching the same thing at the same time, because that's what happened to be on TV at 7 o'clock on a Monday evening. These people are going to college, and it's such a problem that we've already covered stories on Frame Rate where colleges are trying to work out licensing deals to where people can watch whatever they want on their laptops, because television and real-time viewing is just dumb across the board. That next 5 years, I think it's definitely going to double again, maybe even triple.
And 5 million households, just less than half of those households are younger than 35.
Wow.
So the people in the households are younger than 35. So, you know, you're talking about roommates, It's not dorm rooms, because I don't know that Nielsen still goes into dorm rooms yet. But you're talking about, you know, people who are either off campus college or just out of college, and they're just like, no TV. And frankly, that would have been me. I did not have TV out of college. I had cable TV when I was in the dorms because it was provided. But once I moved out in college and then even after college for years in Austin, I did not have cable television. And if I had had Hulu and Netflix and all of the online resources that I have now, I probably would have never gone back to it.
Yep. Well, and plus, like, I mean, I remember there was a time when, like, we just couldn't afford out of college, where it's like, why should I get cable? There's only one channel I'd want to watch. I remember watching the local WB network, because it was literally the only channel that you could get in Austin at the time over the air. And I remember people handing me VHS tapes of episodes of South Park or whatever. It's like the fact that a much higher fidelity version of that experience still exists for everyone who has an internet connection. It's kind of a no-brainer, but it is good to see the validation of what we've suspected on this show for a very long time.
75% of the no TV households have a television, so they're it's a misnomer. It's no cable TV, I guess would be a better way of saying it, maybe. 67% still watch video content, 37% on a computer, 16% on the television with an internet connected television, and 8% on smartphones, only 6% on tablets. I thought that was interesting that more watched on smartphones than tablets in this survey.
Well, and keep in mind also, I think part of that is that smartphones are available in places where tablets aren't necessarily. Tablet is, I think, in general, a lean-back, at-home watching experience. A lot of times before I go to bed, I'll watch something on a tablet or part of it and then go to sleep. But, like, when you're on the subway, you're not going to bust out your tablet to watch it. You're going to just catch a little bit more of your story on the smartphone. So I think the smartphone number is a direct result of opening up TV viewing experiences that previously simply did not exist, whereas I feel like the tablet number is a little bit of stealing away that places that might have been traditional for you to watch regular television.
Yeah, that's a really good point. There's also just the fact that not as many people have tablets. So, you know, that's a little bit of a higher end item right now, whereas smartphones have
Everybody.
Become fairly ubiquitous.
Sure, absolutely. Yeah.
All right, let's take a quick break and thank our sponsor for today's episode of Framerate, Squarespace, the all-in-one platform that makes it fast and easy to create a professional website, blog, portfolio. And now, guess what, Brian?
What? Wait.
You want to make a website that sells things?
Yeah. You know what? I was going to make the Framerate Frisbee store, where you can get frisbees that say Framerate and has You're in My Picture, that one that Lynn Peralta drew of the two of us. But the problem awesome. Is I got no way to do it. It's not possible. I'm too dumb. I don't know nothing about
it. The new commerce solution from Squarespace, you can sell your stuff immediately right now. Go and start it out. You can integrate it with your Squarespace template, or you can start from scratch if you got a Frisbee store you want to start. And guess what? You might think, well, Tom, that's great. I want to sell that Frisbee, but what about the digital copies of the art? You could sell those too, Brian.
So here's the thing. A lot of time when we talk about certain things, and this runs into a situation with a lot of sponsors. For years, I listened to Leo talk about stamps.com, and it never mattered to me because I didn't need it, right? But then all of a sudden, I launched my store, and I needed stamps, and so we used it. This someone out there right now is listening to us talk about Squarespace, and yes, you don't have anything to sell right now. You don't have that million-dollar idea right now. But at some point, some hilarious gaffe happens to the new Pope and you happen to be watching. You have the most hilarious drawing in your head for like something with a crazy Pope hat on a Frisbee. And we're talking idea to execution in minutes, less than an hour. Boom, you jump on, you throw it on there, your commerce active. That efficiency is what could potentially make you a bazillionaire. So even if you don't plan to do it right now, even if you don't have a project that you need to get a discount by using promo code FRAMERATE3 at checkout, which, by the way, what do they get for that?
They get 10% off their first purchase on new accounts, Brian.
See, and here's my point, is at some point you will have one of those ideas. And you remember us and you remember Squarespace because they're the ones who could take you from idea to execution in the shortest amount of time with the highest amount of convenience, fidelity, gorgeous looking templates and layouts. You'll be professional and it'll be up and running. You'll be making money in no time.
Yeah, you know what? And there's probably a few people out there who are like, you know, I do have an idea, but I don't want to like mess with accepting payments. Squarespace does that for you. Accept payments right away, credit or debit cards. Yeah, but then there's order management and tracking and email updates and shipping labels. Single interface for all that stuff on Squarespace. And you're like, well, I might want to try it, but I don't know if I want to go on pay for a plan right away. I mean, I know it's only $24 a month when you sign up for a year, but I'm not sure if I want to be in business. Go try it out for free. You don't even have to give them a credit card. Free trial right now. Squarespace.com. Boom. No credit card needed. If you do decide to purchase it, like Brian mentioned, that offer code FRAMERATE3 works for 10% off your first purchase on new accounts. And if you do buy the year, you get a free domain registration. So you're like, wait a minute, I get a domain and a store all in one? Yes, that's Squarespace. Use the offer code FRAMERATE3. Everything you need to create an exceptional website. And you know what we do, Brian?
What?
We thank them for their support of FRAMERATE.
And we honor them. And we give them a hug, maybe just a little bit too long, something that shows that we really care. And maybe you do the 1-2 pat, the pat, but then you do the rub on the back.
You do a little
shows
rub,
that you really
and
care.
Then it's like,
eh. And then one more pat, because you don't want it to be too weird. And then you get back and maybe you wipe the tear from your eye and you're like, no, man, it's been great, Squarespace. We really appreciate you. Thanks. Yeah.
That's it. That's what we do. Let us swim into the slipstream. I'm starting to think we should break up the slipstream. It's like, you know, Microsoft or Ma Bell or something. Like, all the stories are in the slipstream.
Yeah, but you know what? There's an ebb and a flow to it. You know, it's like around CES time, it's all tube tops. Now it's all slipstream. So let's go ahead and dive in. Right.
Twitch TV has got record-breaking growth. 28 million unique viewers in February.
Now, here's the I don't know if you know this or if I've misunderstood, but I've always thought Twitch TV was just a different brand of Justin.TV. Is it an actual separate network or just sitting on
By Justin TV, but they count the viewers separately, yeah.
Okay, no, I mean, it's fantastic. And we've said this over and over and over again. If there's one, the biggest surprise to me is how much people love watching other people play video games. Because I guess it's kind of all win because you get to absorb the story of the video game if they're playing a single character narrative, or you get to absorb the story of the interaction that they're having with commentary layer over it. I mean, look, this service is made of win, and I love the folks over at Justin TV, which, disclosure, I make no money, but I have my Scam School Brian channel on Justin TV, and I love playing video games in front of other people. So on one hand, it's not really a surprise, but on the other hand, that's pretty amazing growth. 28 billion.
People talk about live sports. For some people, this is their live sports, right? Esports is what they want to watch. They don't care about people with circular objects running around on a field.
That's correct.
They care
That's
about
correct. Well, and think about
that.
Like,
in the rear.
But think about this. Like, why do people like sports in general? Now, there are people who like football who've never played it, but I think by and large, they're all games that we played as kids, so we understand the rules and we can project ourselves into this narrative that's happening. That's for this generation coming up now. There's a hell of a lot more people who can project themselves in the narrative of a Call of Duty game than can into a championship basketball game. And
StarCraft.
Think that it's only going to get bigger and bigger. If you speak the language of StarCraft, if you know the difference between, you know, a Zerg Rush and a, I don't play enough to know what else to say, but then
the rear
you,
with the gear. There, I said it right.
Exactly. if you speak that language and you can inject yourself in that situation and realize, like, man, I don't know how I'd respond to this, and see somebody masterfully pull off a counterattack, then you have a much different appreciation for it than somebody who's just tuning into it. You know, it's like if you've never curled before, you think curling is stupid as a sport. But if you have curled, then you appreciate good curlers.
Jason Kilar is leaving Hulu.
This is the first I've heard about it.
We've only been covering it
for a year.
but he announced in a blog post that following his departure, Andy Forsell, this company's senior vice president of content, will be named the acting CEO. If you don't know who Forsell is, he's the guy who signed CBS to a multi-year licensing deal for back catalog TV. Chicago Tribune says he also led the charge to bring original programming onto Hulu, things like Kevin Smith's Spoilers, according to The Next Web. And in January, a lot of people kind of thought, well, if Kilar's leaving for sure, then maybe this is the guy. So there's, you know, a nice email from Kilar saying, you're in good hands with Forsell.
So we don't know, you know, Killar's always been a bit of a firebrand who took big risks and went different directions. Is from what we know, and I'm asking genuinely because I don't know nothing, but Andy Forsell, is he more a company man or does he have big plans the way we perceived Killar did?
I kind of told you about everything I really can honestly say I know about Andy Forsell just now. Like, I've never met the guy, haven't heard anybody talk about what he's like internally or anything like that. So, you know, that doesn't mean it's not out there somewhere, but I haven't
run across it. So what you're saying is if people want to wildly and irresponsibly speculate about what Andy Forsell will do for Hulu, they should send us an email to fr@twit.tv, right?
I mean, he's a former U.S. Army captain.
Sure, so, which means you will have to salute Hulu in order to watch it. Yeah. It's a pay-for-salute program they're doing.
He's worked in product development, customer care, data center at Oracle and Siebel Systems. So he's an industry veteran. All personality right. type, I have no idea.
Sure.
Are you excited about the actual for real launch of Redbox Instant?
I don't know about excited. Curious? Can I say honestly
you're
curious?
Redbox curious?
I'm a little red curious. I'm not ashamed to admit it. You know, it's like you know, some people are just Netflix people, some people are box people, red box people. But you know, it's like straddle the fence. You know, why not do both?
$8 a month gets you 4 DVDs and then unlimited access to the 4,000 streaming movies they have, which are all pretty much from Epix.
Yeah. Man, it's tough. It's almost not even fair. Like, I feel like we should judge this on the promise of what it can be, not what it actually is. But then again, I don't know. It's very weird.
It's Redbox Instant, powered by Verizon. And what's interesting about it is they are focusing on movies. They're like, we are not Netflix. We are not about TV shows. We're about movies. And I think they're trying to bridge the gap by saying, you'll get the DVDs you love from Redbox, but then also get this little bonus of being able to watch movies at home on your computer. And in a way, when you think about Redbox's audience is different from Netflix's audience because up until now, they were all DVD watchers. This is what Netflix did when they launched Netflix Instant Streaming. They said, hey, you guys like the DVDs? We're going to throw in some videos for free that you could stream. And they had a very small catalog.
Do you think like Redbox is more of like a red state thing, more of a traditionalist? Like, I like to go and to get my McDonald's and grab me a movie for $1 per night, and I take a movie and I take it back. It's simple.
Do we have to do that? I hate that. I hate the red what? Blue state.
Dude, I'll say it now. Like, Netflix needs to change their background color to blue because this is a red blue state extravaganza. There's a culture war going on, Mary.
I know
don't
Netflix
you understand?
Says we're born in Silicon Valley, but can we see their incorporation papers?
Are you a Netflixer? All you damn Netflixers out there talking about your streaming movies. I'll tell you what, being an American, I'm a red boxer. I don't care. You give me a disc, I pop it in like an American would. All this communist streaming movie BS. Go back to your Pirate Bay, future boy. Sorry, I don't know where that came from.
I will. By the way, you know the oldest torrent on Pirate Bay is actually a documentary about Linux.
That's awesome.
They've learned that earlier today. CBS launching an iOS streaming TV app that allows you to watch new episodes of their shows with a 1 week delay. For some of the shows, things like CSI, How I Met Your Mother, Late Show with David Letterman, with a 24-hour primetime. Some primetime shows will arrive on the eighth day after broadcast, but that's a Beatles week.
Yeah, so that was the question I was going to ask, because I know that was one of the issues we had with Hulu was doing an eight-day behind thing to where, like, you could never, ever quite get caught up as long as you were watching on Hulu. I wonder if the 1 week delay thing seems good. I just wonder if I guess you answered my question that some of them will be eight days. So
yeah, it's the late Sorry. Show and daytime stuff will be the day after. It'll be 24 hours later. So you'll be able to watch Letterman on these apps the next night. But everything else is 8 days. Currently iOS, but CBS says Android and Windows Phone 8. Or it says Windows 8 here, so maybe they actually mean Windows 8 App Store are coming soon.
Well, regardless,
I applaud the effort
across the board.
BitTorrent, another thing came out of beta. BitTorrent Live Streaming is now here for people to try at BitTorrent Live. You can go to live.bittorrent.com. P2P streaming protocol that Bram Cohen, the founder of the BitTorrent protocol, is bringing to you folks. And the idea is that you can do a live video channel without having to have all the bandwidth and cost of infrastructure available that like a Ustream or somebody has, because it's using peer-to-peer.
So have you personally streamed anything on BitTorrent? I guess Twit has one of these BitTorrent streams, or we've played with it.
Yeah, well, I haven't personally streamed anything, but I have looked at the Twit stream back when we were doing it in the beta, and it looked great. Right.
Yeah. Well, regardless, I think it's not only a good idea, but an important idea, because, yes, people will say, oh, this just encourages people to stream that upcoming Wolverine movie. It's Wolverine all over again. But those people shut the hell up.
Not at all. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, those people shut the hell up when you have an Arab Spring type of moment. And I'm really hopeful that this will be for the next important political sea change, that something like technology like this could play a very important role.
Yeah, the idea for this is you don't have to go through another service to stream. So Correct. You don't have to. Yeah, even though like things like Ustream are great and they're free, they are only free up to a certain level. And what BitTorrent's trying to say is like you can be in charge of your own stream and roll it yourself. You don't have to give anything to anybody else. You don't have to put up with ads being run in front of your stuff or anything. You can just stream it, and you don't have to have a ton of bandwidth and codec servers and all of that sort of thing. So we'll, now that it's wide open, it'll be interesting to see who makes good use of it. But it's very cool.
Yeah.
Fox Mobile app has added TV Everywhere streaming with authentication. So you have to actually say, yes, I am a member of a participating television provider, which in this case I think is just Fios and one other. Trying to find the other one.
Regardless, here. There's only one word that matters in this headline, my friend, and it's the S word. And I don't mean streaming.
Well, 24 hours. I haven't got to that yet.
All right, go ahead. Yeah, you finish the headline.
Trying to find the, it's a MediaCom and Verizon Fios allows you to get the TV Everywhere. But separately, there is Fox Sports Channel launching this fall in competition with ESPN, and they will have a Fox Sports Go mobile experience with some live video streaming.
This is huge. Like sports has been a sticking point on the transition to a cable-free experience. We've already talked about stories about how sports is a total pain in the butt because you got people who don't care about sports networks who are subsidizing them because ESPN pays for or requires people to pay to have them coverage on their channel. But likewise, if we could see an alternative way to get the people who want the sports the most to pay the most, then all of a sudden you get a much more efficient user experience for everyone in general. So this is a significant advance. I think we're going to hear a lot more about.
I kind of think it's not going to end up being that significant. And here's why. ESPN already does this. ESPN has the ability to watch live streaming sports from ESPN when you authenticate with your provider. Or if you get ESPN 360 on an ISP that supports ESPN 360. What Fox is going to do with this is they're going to have a limited number of streaming. It's not going to be everything. And they're going to make you authenticate just like they are with the other television apps they do.
It's baby steps, Tom. Baby steps.
It's not an advance because ESPN's already doing it.
Yeah, but no. But it's one of those things. It's like the advance doesn't happen necessarily with the people at the forefront of it. The advance happens when the people at the back move forward, and it becomes the new standard. The fact that it is significant that you know, and I'm sure there's other carriers that need to get on board, other stations that need to get on board. But like the fact that this is an indication that it's becoming expected that you do this. That's the first thing that has to happen. Then the question becomes, well, does everyone have to do it in this kludgy way that involves paying for cable and then bringing it up?
Also, Vimeo is opening up a limited trial of their on-demand service to more people. If you're a paying Vimeo Pro user, you can now create a for-pay channel. You can still have free stuff up as well, but you can say like, oh, if you want to watch this whole documentary, you know, give us $2, et cetera. I think you're allowed to set the price and sell your content. You do have to be a pro user, which is not cheap. It's $200 a year.
Right. But keep in mind also that it's a built-in structure that that's a trusted name. So it's like, you know, you could have your own instructional videos on your Rinky Dink website, but it won't quite carry the weight that a Vimeo branded experience has. The rates are pretty good, a little bit expensive in that you have to give 10% of the profits to Vimeo, which compared
that's
to
nothing, though. I mean, when you consider the 30-70 splits that are the norm.
If you sell the video directly off of your website, you've got your own bandwidth costs. But of course, credit card payments, you're looking at what, 2 or 3%. 10% is a bit more, but you get a structure to where you have a library and people are able to access it at all times. And I'll tell you, I've mentioned this before, this is of extreme interest to me as we continue to build the catalog of magic tutorials for pay on scamstuff.com. You know, we're starting to do more advanced tricks. And right now what we're doing is we're using a e-commerce solution that sends out, you download an actual video, but we're already running into situations where people are like, I lost my video, can I get it again? That kind of thing. And of course, you have to deal with torrent issues and all of that. Whereas this is a very attractive solution, even though it would be more expensive compared to what we're doing right now, it would be a structure to where people could access these instructional videos anytime. So I think it's great.
Yeah, I guess it all depends on how you look at it, whether it's more or less expensive than what you're already doing. Because I get what you're saying. And it is more expensive than that because you're like, oh, I mean, I'm going to get 10% over. But to somebody who's used to selling content through an app store or through an ebook store, 10% sure. Just seems like wow, that's nothing.
Compared to like I think the best rates, what is it, on Amazon, if you have a 99-cent ebook on Amazon, they take 70%. You get 30, yeah. I think it's like 33 cents for every dollar spent. Yeah. It's ridiculous. And it's like, Amazon is a great experience from the user point of view, but they're the Walmart of the internet. And as a content creator, Amazon has not been a good deal. Much, much better has been iTunes, but even then you get 66 cents out of a dollar for your 99-cent download. So the idea of Vimeo day one, like charge a dollar, get 90%, there's nothing in media facilitators out there that's anywhere near as good as that rate.
Very quickly, folks, so don't be disappointed. We have one story in Tube Tops. And it's not even that big of a story. It's just that the XBMC team has started working on version 13, codenamed Gotham, of the next version of XBMC. Remember, we mentioned that XBMC 12 Frodo was already out. Well, Gotham has been officially announced. They're working on it. Feature improvements to UPnP with a play-using menu. If you've used Play 2 on Windows, you might be familiar with that. Also, no Android fixes that let it rotate in any direction when you're on Android. And you can control the device's native audio. There's some other changes in there as well. So just kind of a note, because more and more people using the XBMC, especially if you want to roll your own media server, you can put it on pretty much anything you can think of.
Well, as your average consumer, I think I can, at this announcement, honestly ask, what's in Film Found?
Now, when I talk about breaking up Slipstream, here's one of the things I'm thinking, all right? I'm always thinking.
I know, I'm following you.
I put the Veronica Mars story in here originally. Now I'm deleting it because we already covered it. I forgot to move it up. But I'm thinking Film Found shouldn't just be what to watch, but the channels that bring it to you. Because what we didn't used to have was a distinction there, right? It was like you had your services like Netflix and Hulu. You had your shows, and they were either independent and original or they were network stuff being repurposed.
Sure.
And then you had your devices. But now you're starting to see more and more people creating their own channels.
Let's
like
just
Machinima,
call it,
et cetera. They're not the service.
Slipstream is structural focused. Film is content focused. So branding a group of content under a specific brand, a channel, is much more Film Found than Slipstream. So it was proclaimed.
Jason, I'm going to go to what was the last story in your lineup, the Ridley Scott story, because this is not about a particular thing to watch, but Ridley Scott teaming up with Machinima to create 12 original sci-fi short films directed by people from Ridley Scott's operation. His operation, what is his operation called again?
I don't know what the name is, but first of all, two things. Number one, I was really surprised because
RSA. Ridley Scott's production company is called RSA. You know who's at RSA?
Catherine Bigelow, Zero Dark Thirty, Martin Scorsese, Goodfellas, Sam Mendes, Joe Carnahan, Neil Blomkamp. Not to say these guys are necessarily going to direct something for Machinima, but there's going to be 12 movies coming out of this thing.
So this is interesting. This is a case where it's like, it seems like Machinima is sort of doing a balancing act where it's like their core brand is video game related stuff, which is why they appeal to young males under 24 years old. But when you have that very precious demographic, you got to think of other bigger ways to reach them with other content. And I think that I know that when they got Battlestar Galactica Blood and Chrome, that it was interesting because they brought in a much older non-video game related demographic. So to be honest, I had expected that that was going to be a one-off opportunity for them and that they would go back to their core with video game related content. But the fact that they're doing this says that maybe they really appreciated that bump, or that there's an opportunity to figure a way to monetize this very particular demographic that they seem to have a lock on.
Yeah, and this is the next web story actually speculates that Machinima has been touted around as one of the leading candidates to test a YouTube on-demand pay-us-for-video strategy that has been rumored, a la the Vimeo one we were talking about earlier. And so this might be the kind of thing that would go into that, is like, oh, we're going to have some high-quality top directors doing things for Machinima that are the kind of things that this audience likes, but you're going to have to pay a couple bucks to watch them. And that makes sense.
If they can crack that nut and they could be the ones to figure out how to get 17-year-olds to pay for video content, then they got the keys to the internet, my friend. It's going to be a great day to be part of the Machinima team.
Now, and this is the thing, as we've done this show now for almost 3 years, sooner or later, we'll be heading to our third year soon. We used to go to Film Found, and it would be like a major movie is coming to the studios that is geeky enough that we're all going to want to watch it, or there's this really nifty new, like, independent YouTube thingy that's kind of cool. And look at what they're doing on YouTube. Now we're getting Ridley Scott and his amazing tribe of directors are going to make things. And you can argue whether this is actually quality or not, depending on your taste. But Simon Cowell is a big name, and he is hosting The U Generation, a partnership with YouTube, to do an online talent search a la American Idol or X Factor on YouTube.
Dude, say what you will about Simon Cowell, that dude is a juggernaut. And if he is even paying lip service to the idea that that this is where the action is, and I think there's no doubt about it. You talk to the folks in Hollywood, you know, they're playing their game, but they're all looking to create a more internet-like experience. It's good news. Whether or not you're going to like this particular thing, it doesn't matter. The point is there's more social proof that this is where the action is, which means more players are going to gravitate to this space and get you the experiences that you want.
And he's doing more than just paying lip service. The competition is going to launch in 26 countries starting Wednesday, March 20th, run for 52 weeks. Live stream kicks it off at 3 p.m. Eastern time on the 20th. Features an interview with One Direction, who were discovered by Simon Cowell. And every submission will be judged by executives and experts picked by Simon Cowell, either from his company or people he knows. And finalists will be chosen every 2 weeks, with the winner being announced on the second Friday of every contest. And then there'll be kind of a grand finale at the end of the 52 weeks.
Look, that's great for the industry, blah, blah, blah. Let's move on to a story I really just sincerely care about. Go.
Game of Thrones.
Yes!
Trailer Palooza this past week. They're all over the place. Small trailers, long trailers, beast trailers, war trailers. There's too many trailers, but I love watching every one of them.
Since you posted this story in the document, we've got that one. Somebody in the chat room is going to have to find it. But like, there was one that used the soundtrack of Daft Punk from Tron Legacy in it. And it just felt weird, but kind of awesome. It felt a little bit like Lady Hawk. I don't know if you remember from the 80s, but they had this synthesizery, which is very anachronistic. But it's like, I don't know why hard rock and death metal guitar would be any less of an anachronism than techno Daft Punkness, but there was something about it that felt just a little bit weird.
And it's got me excited. Of course, it premieres here in the U.S. on HBO on Sunday, March 31st. No
Thrones.
You're excited. You're not down on Game of Thrones, right?
Oh, my God, no. You know why? Because Game of Thrones is batting 1,000. They understand pacing, and the writing is just exquisite. The storytelling is incredible. There's no wasted episodes. I cannot point to a single episode of Game of Thrones where I'm like, well, that was a waste of time. Everything advances the larger story. Everything just sucks you in deeper. Everything gives you a bigger and better context for what's happening. And it just so happens, and I'm not even going to say that it's exactly like the books, because it's not. They've made some big changes from the books, but they did it for a reason, not just because, well, I think it's time to tinker with the story. They did it because, like, well, we think we could tell the story more efficiently, or we can add an element that will fill a void by doing this. This is in my adult life, quite possibly the most compelling series in television ever. I can think of nothing that is better. I mean, it's up there, certainly up there with The Wire and The Shield and those amazing stories.
That's Storm of Swords is the third book. They're going to cover half of that book. I don't know if it's going to be like the first half or just they're going to pick and choose. But there's going to be two seasons based on A Storm of Swords. And in my opinion, Storm of Swords is the pinnacle of the series so far. I mean, there's been a lot of buildup, a lot of getting to know a lot of characters and getting them into position. And now it's just going to be action, action, action this season. I hope.
This is it. This is huge. Very excited about it. If you haven't watched it, please, please, please jump on, because people are saying that they're sad that there's not been spoiler zones lately. Get ready for like 3 whole months, none but spoiler zones every single episode.
So that is kind of premiering this week, if you will. But we can go ahead and play the premiering this week thing.
Premiering this week! This is what's premiering this week! Check it out!
Because there's also The Croods, which tells the story of the world's first family road trip when the Croods cave is destroyed. So, and that's actually got 80% Rotten Tomatoes.
Yeah, it's kind of weird because you got something that sounds so goofy when you say it. I mean, even listing the actors in it or whatever, an animated feature, it's so easy to make it sound goofy, but 82% positive Rotten Tomatoes reviews, that ain't nothing. And so it's probably awesome, even though it doesn't sound like it's going to be awesome.
Let's talk about what we're watching. What we're watching. I want to get my three out of the way real quickly. One is Archer is still brilliant every week. Not disappointed. I'm on a Futurama kick. I'm almost caught up, though. I've watched them all. I'm just watching them all again. Walking Dead. I wanted to get to this one. I thought maybe this week would be the week that I would say to you, Brian Brushwood, now it's time to dive back in.
People were telling me that. I got Twitters, people saying like, oh, you wanted one more? You got it, son. It's time. But Tom, what do you say?
I didn't like this as much as they did.
Really?
I felt this episode was a lot of dancing around, like, come on, let's just get on with it. We know where this is going. Let's get there.
All right. Well, I mean, I'll watch it. Although I tell you what, like, nobody's harping on me for not watching Archer. Love Archer. Here's the weird part is I just literally cannot be bothered to walk all the way into the living room to set up, to program a DVR to watch Archer. It's like, as much as I love it and I can't wait to see all of them, I'm just so like that stupid channel. I can't you page up over and over and over again, scroll through the days, find it, and then you hit record, and then you find out that you didn't do the HD version. It's the SD version. It's
classic Brian.
Lazy. That's me. That's my brand. That's how I do.
What have you been watching?
I told you I've been watching School of Thrones, which is what precipitated the, as the story gets more interesting in ways that has nothing to do with parody, that's what precipitated the conversation we had at the beginning of the show. But I started up Downton Abbey, finally, and I've only gotten like halfway through the first episode. Nice. This is not my usual flavor of show, Tom, and I'm going to ask you, as somebody who knows what I'm up to, should I believe the hype? Because everybody really seems to dig it. Do you believe I'll be sucked in? That's he says as his pinky is up in the air drinking his tea.
I hope you'll be quite satisfied with it, Brian.
All right. Well, I'll report in. I'll let you know what
I think.
Okay,
here's the thing. Lots of people who like Downton Abbey surprised me. I like Downton Abbey because I am a sucker for that time period. I love that time period. One of my favorite authors of all time is Evelyn Waugh. That whole like decline of the British aristocracy is just fascinating to me. So I love it. So, right. And that makes it almost impossible for me to tell you anybody else if they'll love it or not if they don't have that same love for the trappings of it. It's like the Mad Men of that era.
I do, man, that analog world and seeing how many things are exactly the same as they were in the old days, but in what ways they use human labor in order to achieve the same means is fascinating to me. You know, like the way that telecommunications was in its infancy with, you know, with literally the telegraph. I suspect I'll like it quite a bit. And there's, I'm into enough of, you know, they've only gotten into as far as like, who will inherit Downton Abbey legacy? Like that stuff doesn't naturally attract me, but I do agree with you. Like that world and that classicism, I think is fascinating to go back and look at.
Shall we move on to feedback?
Yeah.
Now it's time for feedback with Brian and Tom on Frame Rate. Oh, yeah.
This is our feedback about being a Nielsen family that we had from last week that we didn't have time to get to. So we're going to do it this week, by gum. This person is under NDA, and so we have to say that there is no such person, that we're totally making up this email, but it's totally true.
Correct. That's responsible journalism there, Tom. I like your style, kid.
To just hook up three TVs, they came in with two large tubs filled with wires and boxes, more than doubling the number of wires I had behind my TV. Every TV gets its own box called the people meter. This is actually public knowledge, right, with a remote control. They also install a lot of other equipment behind your TV. They tap into the sound of your TV. They tap into the sound of every device hooked up to the TV, even your DVD, your Roku, your computer, video games. You're not allowed to hook anything new up to the TV by yourself. You have to call them in and have them install it for you. And if you go too long without using a certain device, they call and ask you like, okay, are you not using this device anymore? Why is that? They just want to make sure nothing's broken. All the TVs send their information to one master unit that sends the data out using a cell signal. During the initial setup, they test that they are receiving audio from every device using their laptop. They also listen to every cable channel for a couple seconds so that they know what channels you receive, and this takes forever. Then, at the beginning, you have to take a fairly long survey, and about every 3 months, they will call you to do another smaller survey asking questions like, have you bought soda or table wine in the past 3 months? I'm going to skip some of this stuff, but every family member gets their own dedicated button. Every 42 minutes, when the people meter starts to blink, you have to press your button to indicate you're still watching TV. If you do not press your button right away, more and more lights start blinking until all 16 lights are blinking. I don't know how long it takes, but they will stop counting your TV if you don't press a button. If a non-family member is watching TV, they have to log in with their age and sex. And if they see the TV on and you go too long without logging in, they will call you to find out who is watching TV. During the setup, they'll ask you if you pause your TV for long periods of time because they don't like having the TV on without hearing sound. They also ask if you fall asleep with the TV on at night so they can factor that into the ratings. You are not allowed to tell anyone you're a family member. You do not have you, but you do have to explain it to people who come over to watch TV. You have to let them know if anyone's moved in or out of your house, et cetera, et cetera. It goes on and on. It's very long, yeah, well, and detailed.
And specifically, like, one of the things people ask is, like, how much do you get paid for it? I think he said, like, for a two-year thing, you got paid, like, $150 or something ridiculous, stupid.
Yeah, it's very low. I thought he did say in here. He says, a lot of people complain about Nielsen not being accurate. I am in no way standing up for them. Some believe it would be more accurate to get information straight from the cable box. I believe there are a few problems with this. There's no way of telling if someone's actually watching TV or if it's just on. You would also have to trust the cable company, which I don't think anyone does. You would also not get data about usage from other devices other than the cable box itself. I believe Nielsen should expand the number of houses that get the people meter, and views should be counted the same regardless of the source. Well, Nielsen's taking care of that second part.
Right.
But they feel like 3,000 houses is enough to provide a statistically significant sample that is representative within a small enough margin of error.
Right, and it is. I mean, it's like you know, there's that standard deviation. If you've taken statistics, you know that as small a number as 3,000 people feel compared to 300 million Americans, the fact is that it is accurate within, you know, whatever 98-99% for it. So it's like I trust that. There's too much money on the line for them not to hire the right statistical experts to figure all this kind of thing out, as long as they have representative groups of all of these different individuals. So it's like, I don't fault them for any of that.
$150 at the beginning and then $50 every 6 months.
Ooh, $50, you say?
Yeah.
That's
a lot of trouble to go through.
That's almost 30 cents per time you have to press the button.
It's one of those situations where they know that people get enthusiastic about being the Nielsen family because then their viewing actually counts. And so they give them a little money to say, oh, you know, we're not going to just take advantage of you and make you do this for free, but it doesn't have to be a lot.
All right. So before we wrap things up here, I actually have something that I want to show you. Somebody just now in the chat room, I can't say who, but his name rhymes with Blonely Bot Bleak. And maybe he's the person who did all of our motion graphics for the summer movie draft. And maybe he just leaked to me a screen capture of the motion graphics for the upcoming summer movie draft. It's going to be amazing, dude. It looks amazing.
Whole new look.
I know. I'm so excited about this. It's going to be awesome.
Wait, put that back up again.
There you go.
NSFW show. Then what's the really small thing?
NSFW show presents draft summer 2013.
Draft, yeah. Summer 2013. Love it. Love it.
Looks great. I guess what he's saying is that it's time to start thinking about it. I guess in the next couple of weeks, we're going to have to do our draft because I think the first movie is like the second or third week in August or April, right?
Yeah. Dan Dirks has got the thing all set up and ready to go. So
that's all up. Start checking out the movies at draft.nsfwshow.com. We're going to announce our official slate of participants. And I'll tell you what, Tom, me and Justin were talking about maybe launching another podcast that's just like a short 15-minute weekly show about nothing but the movie draft.
That'd be kind of fun. Yeah.
It would.
I'd be into that. I mean, we I need another show. It's like a hole in my head.
Yeah, right. Right on, man. Dude, yeah, is that
Oblivion kicks it off April 19th.
Okay, there we go. Right on. All right, that's
for frame rate.
Yes. Send your questions to fr@twit.tv. If you think Brian's just an idiot who can't think of anything and can't express himself properly when it comes to parody, let me know. Or if you have more examples of exactly what it is, if you get what I'm trying to say and you could correct me, then make sure to make that happen as well. Get ready for the frame rate movie draft.
All right, you can find us on the web, twit.tv/fr, and of course we stream live at live.twit.tv every Monday at 6:30 p.m. Eastern, 3:30 p.m. Pacific. We'll see you next time.
Bye. Nobody understood my position, and then I hit upon the analog that I made in that thing, where it's like, in a universe where people pay a lot of money for the right to reimagine other people's works, the question is it parody or reimagining? Because I watched the second episode of School of Thrones, and it's looking more and more like a reimagining and less like a parody. Like, I didn't laugh once. And they were like...
Well, but that's... I mean, I don't know what else I can add to say. I think you want it to be a controversy, maybe, but...
No. This is like... This is the way my brain works, is looking at soft spots. I love when I almost said the S word, stuff is black and white. But when there's this gray wiggle room, I love figuring out, what is the line? What is
the
right?
Here's why I'm having the reaction I am, is that I am like that too. Essentially probably 40% of my TNT stories are examining that line in lots of different areas. This is not a good example of the line. This isn't far from the line, but it's over there on the line. So it's just, to me, it's like, nah, if you want to educate somebody about where the line is and where the controversy is and why there's an issue with copyright law, this is not the example to do it with.
Yes. Well,
because you keep saying all of these, like, but what if I did? What if I did? What if this happened? And you don't, because there aren't any actual examples of this being a problem.
Right. Yes. Correct.
So it's you're kind of making up examples that are a little different to get you closer to the line.
Right, but this
example isn't close to that line. Does that make sense?
Well, I don't know. Have you watched the second episode yet?
No, I haven't.
It's less and less funny and more and more.
But
its
that
own.
Doesn't but see that doesn't make it less or more legal.
Well, it does if it ceases.
The court doesn't judge on humor. The court judges on four factors. Is it undermining the audience? Is it taking a substantial portion? Is it commentary or educational? And now I'm blanking on the fourth factor. But it doesn't have a scientific or artistic value, and this doesn't this meets
but that's
enough
for,
of those factors fair. That it's just not an issue. You're not taking at best, you could say there's a trademark infringement here, I would guess, because you're using actual Stark names, et cetera, et cetera. But again, there's not likely to be brand confusion. Nobody's likely to watch this and think they are watching the HBO show and therefore not go and buy HBO. So it's just not a very good example.
Yeah. I guess, okay. Well, regardless, the bummer for me was that all of the responses were like, here's a series that does a parody from time to time, so therefore you're wrong. It's like, that just makes me think I fundamentally miscommunicated my point. Like I could not think of a single other series that took a currently in production intellectual property and used all the same characters, all the same names, week after week to tell.
But it doesn't matter whether it's week after week. That's what I kept trying to say last week, was it the periodicity of it doesn't change the legality in any way.
The
court
okay.
looks at a case of usage, and repeated usage doesn't change the factors of the defense.
Man, I just like by that logic, though, there's some horrific crap that suddenly becomes plausible. Like could I take, and people have pointed out like the Family Guy thing with the Star Wars franchise, but that was all done with Lucasfilm's permission and in tandem with. But are you telling me that Family Guy could have done all that? Like a series? Like
here's why they did it with permission.
All right, no,
because,
here's
the difference. They could have done it, and they could have gone to court, and they could have won, possibly, depending on how they did it.
Don't believe that. That's crazy.
But what they don't have that Lucas has is a lot of money. And what you want to do is avoid court. It's almost always a game of chicken of, are these guys going to get angry? And I think where this comes down to is the HBO and the publishers and George R. R. Martin are not getting angry. So there is no issue.
Well, okay.
Until they get angry. But if you could show me one person that's written a column that says, I'm a lawyer and I think this is going to be a problem, or you can show me that there's like a complaint or a cease and desist has been sent or this or that, with the amount of attention that this has gotten, that should have happened already.
Then
we can have a conversation.
It's not about this thing. It's what this thing means. If we all agree this is okay, then could I personally make Star Wars Detours? Like just make it myself and put it out and assuming Star Wars didn't happen.
You might be able to.
I just don't believe that. I believe you'd be shut down.
Lots of people do Star Wars parodies all the time, and Lucas doesn't go after them because he knows that it's just fanfic, essentially, and he supports that. He thinks it extends the universe. Now, there's a line over which he clearly has said, do not go. And when you're a large enough organization that makes enough money that you could be a target, then it's probably in your best interest to just go and figure out the licensing to begin with. But it's, there's all kinds of, Chad Vader.
Yeah.
He's using the freaking outfit and the name.
No, that's legit. Yeah. Chad Vader would be, I guess that's the problem, is nobody's given me a specific example of anything like it. They've all these, or let me put it this way.
I'll give an example. School of Thrones.
You can't give the exact example that caused the questions.
But you're saying, this is going to be a problem, and it's not.
Don't put words in my mouth. I did not say that. What I said was, I've never seen anything like this, and I can't think of another example like it. And everyone goes, of course there's an example.
And then they proceed.
No. Saturday Night Live is a terrible example. Every example given before you said Chad Vader was a terrible, terrible example of a comedy series that did a one-off parody of something.
Doesn't matter.
Long-running series.
As I mentioned before, it doesn't matter how many times they did it.
But that, again, not relevant to my question. My question was, who else has done this? And until you said Chad Vader, the answer was
question,
no.
Who else has done this now just stands alone and doesn't mean anything. I'm like, well, who cares who else has done it?
Okay, Tom, you're killing me here. I'm not saying I'm a judge. I'm not saying bring down the hammer. I'm saying this is relatively unexplored territory because I can't think of anyone.
Okay, and that's where you're saying, give me examples, because it's not.
Yes,
okay.
Yes. And then you...
Well, but this is a YouTube series. It's much easier to throw together and do.
Like what I was asking for. And then say, oh, Jesus. All right, go ahead. I'm ready. Let's go ahead and start.
All right.
All right.